Hello, Internet. I'm Shane Ormond, and this waste of life is Danny McBride. Welcome to Swishpan.
Swishpan!
I'm not doing it, Danny.
Swishpan!
I'm really not doing it, Danny.
Swishpan!
Swishpan.
Swishpan.
It's a movie show of sorts. For entertainment news tonight, what do you have for us, Danny?
Former TV3 presenter Alan Cantwell is now officially on the dole.
Who's Alan Cantwell?
He is the toad-looking fellow with the orange head who wears auburn suits.
What show would I know him from?
TV3 programs.
I don't really watch TV3.
No one does. Okay. Justin Bieber's mother is producing an anti-abortion film. The question on all our minds, why not abort Bieber? Mel Gibson is rumoured to be the father of Jodie Foster's kids. Did you hear about that?
What?
And she came out at the Golden Globes. She came out publicly. Said she
came
was,
out?
Yes.
Jodie Foster came out?
She is a public lesbian.
Who's Jodie Foster?
Jodie Foster was the 12-year-old prostitute from Taxi Driver.
Oh, I love that.
And she was also Nell, and she made contact in the early 90s with aliens.
Oh, that's pretty good.
Yeah. I don't know if you were watching The Tweenies this week.
I missed it this week. I have it taped, though.
Yeah, it's okay. It was a rerun anyway. So one of the Tweenies came out appearing as Jimmy Savile.
Yeah, I have no problem with that.
Me neither. Let's move on.
No, like, it was a show recorded like 12 years ago, and there's like Jimmy Savile coming out. Kids don't know who Jimmy Savile is. No one was harmed by the show being seen. It was just an oddity in its timing. And it's just kind of women, like middle-aged mothers, getting their knickers in a twist over nothing.
It's okay to dress up like Jimmy Savile because children don't know who he is.
Jimmy Savile is going to be the biggest Halloween... Actually, Jimmy Savile as a tweenie is going to be one of the biggest Halloween costumes this year.
It'll be the new Joker, yeah. isn't it funny though, still everyone goes... There's always one at a fancy dress party dressed up as the Joker from The Dark Knight of Heat 2.
I can't wait to see the Jimmy Savile tweenie Joker. Like, yes. Mashup costume.
I love you. You love me.
Oh, yeah?
We're a happy family.
Okay.
The creator of Barney's son shot somebody in the chest.
Did he kill him?
No. It was apparently just a neighbourly dispute.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so how about that?
Well, they used to use that like music as a form of torture in like Guantanamo Bay.
They still use it as a form of torture.
So I can't imagine like growing up with that in your house is going to be very, you know, conducive to having a healthy, sane mental health.
Well, not anymore. I mean, you know, the connotations. I mean, he was also the inspiration of Barney the Dinosaur, her son.
What does he look like?
Well, I don't know. I personally, I've just seen pictures of Barney holding a fucking...
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Los Angeles County Jail sign.
Actually, the voice of Charlie Brown this week was arrested. He was arrested, which was unusual, for threatening to cause death. So he wasn't making death threats. He was threatening to cause death, and I'm not entirely sure what the difference is between those.
Okay. And threatening to cause death. Okay, what was it? Phone calls? Was it one of these SWAT team duties?
It was four phone calls, I think. And then they caught him actually trying to escape to Mexico.
Who was he threatening?
It hasn't come out yet. Presumably a woman. Presumably a woman who keeps taking away a football anytime that he goes to kick it.
Who's the leading fucking FBI agent chasing him? Was that guy with the blankie?
No, it's just very unusual. Everyone's declining to comment. No other information has come out other than his warrant, which has to be public information.
Have you seen this new trend in Hollywood? It's like people have been pranking celebrities like Tom Cruise, basically. And they've, like, Tom Cruise and someone like, it's not 50 Cent, but someone like 50 Cent. And someone was, I should really know the details before I bring these things up.
Yeah, I have literally no idea what you're talking about.
But what happened anyway in Tom Cruise's instance was that basically somebody had somehow arranged or orchestrated a SWAT team to arrive at his house. So there was some kind of hacker said there was a perimeter breach, and I don't know how it worked out, but it's happened like three times in Hollywood.
That's pretty
this week,
cool.
Yeah, it's pretty odd.
Do you remember we were talking about Collateral last week?
Collateral, yeah, the Tom Cruise movie.
Yeah, it was Tom Cruise's obviously best role. When he was prepared, come on.
Vampire Lestat.
Yeah, those are my two favorites, they're up there.
Yeah,
And I'm not a huge Tom Cruise fan, but I do think those two roles were phenomenal. But when he was trying to prepare for the role of Collateral, the director had him deliver FedEx parcels.
Why?
In like busy markets so that he could blend in like a hitman. And there's even a video of him actually doing it and no one recognizes him. And he sits down with an old man and he talks with the old man. Presumably about Tom Cruise movies, because
yeah.
I don't imagine he has a lot to talk about.
Presumably about Scientology.
Yeah.
You know, apparently he's been called by Scientologists, or I don't know who releases the statement, but the most important person in Scientology since L. Ron Hubbard, or Ron L. Hubbard, whichever it is.
Yeah, L. Ron Hubbard, notably a science fiction author before he invented Scientology.
As I affectionately know him as Mother Hubbard.
Mother Hubbard.
Listen, we better roll a clip.
Oh, yeah.
Or at least get one going on in the background. Hansel and Gretel Witch Hunters.
I really like the look of this trailer.
What is it you like about it?
I don't know. You see, like there was a while there where these kind of movies were actually different and they were actually good. I mean, if you talk about like The Mummy, you know, the kind of reimagining of the classic adventure story. And then you got like the Pirates of the Caribbean, the first one was phenomenal. And then you've got an oversaturation in the market. And when I saw the video, it just reminded me of the first time that I saw the trailers for those ones.
Yeah, but you're comparing it to like the Universal greats, the monster movie greats, Frankenstein, The Mummy and all that. You know, The Mummy is originally a horror, is it not?
Oh no, I'm talking about the remake, The Mummy with the Brendan Fraser. Lads, what?
Unless she has to.
The witch, she killed them, all of them. She gave me a message.
That was awesome.
Where are the children?
There's a place deep in the forest.
There'll be many witches. They'll be too powerful.
Gretel, I see you got my invitation.
I don't think we're hunting witches. I think they're hunting us.
Yeah, like as I was saying, I think it actually like it reminded me of that feeling when I first saw those movies, and it does leave itself open to a load of pitfalls, like you know becoming too like that, you know, punching a witch and then saying a cool line and being too stylish at times.
Hang on now. We're talking about Hansel and Gretel, a fairy tale, okay? I understand where you're coming from in terms of it looks a little adventurous now. What I do like about this a little bit is the idea that it's set years after Hansel and Gretel enter a gingerbread and defeat a witch. Okay, that's a pretty funny setup. Now, here's them in their 20s, brother and sister, now professional witch hunters, okay?
Yeah.
That's a plot that's probably been written on the back of a cigarette box. You know what I mean? It's like one of those simple pitches, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, but it doesn't have to be like an incredible idea to be great in execution. And I know this is probably isn't going to be great, but I'm still optimistic.
I'm just saying, based on the trailer,
yeah,
I think it's going to be rubbish.
I'm more optimistic about Hansel and Gretel than our next movie.
Well, our next movie is Olympus Has Fallen.
Olympus Has Fallen, or as you affectionately know it, Die Hard in the White House.
Die Hard in the White House.
Which I actually think is a better idea, and I think we should try and get a movie made called Die Hard in the White House.
Yeah, yippee-ki-yay, Mr. President.
It doesn't even have to be a Die Hard film.
No, but like I did tell you about this. There's two movies coming out with the exact same plot, right? You got this one, Aaron Eckhart and Gerard Butler.
Yeah. Gerard Butler looks weird without a beard, doesn't he?
Weird without a beard. That should be a segment. In fact, maybe I'll shave my beard for the next one. That could be the segment. Weird without a beard. Can you imagine me without a beard?
Yeah. Look, I'm growing a little.
You are?
Yeah.
Does it join to the back of your head, though?
No, that's...
One all-encompassing mafro.
I think you're the only person that has that joining line there.
If your hair joins to your beard, please send us a picture of your wife's breasts. Getting back to this movie.
Yes.
It looks rubbish. At one point, a plane transforms into a machine gun and attacks the White House.
Yeah, the plane's getting nowhere near the White House.
Yeah.
And it seems like we're just going to hear all the lines that we've already heard in all these action movies, and we're going to see all the scenes that we've seen before. I mean, there's actually a bit in the trailer where they're like, oh, he's a rogue agent. How can he do it? And then he's like, I'm the only one who can.
Yeah.
You know, it's literally no point in seeing the movie. You've seen it already. It's just in the White House.
Yeah, no, I'm definitely going to watch that movie.
Oh, I know you will.
I could get into it. I'm not going to. I know it's going to be a fucking 2-star film, but I'm ready to embrace its wonders.
Okay, I think we actually have the clip now. If you want to have a look at it.
Yeah, we'll roll into a segment.
Everybody knows you did the right thing on that bridge. Even the president knows. You got to learn how to get back into the real world.
President, we're ready for you.
Our guests have arrived.
I'd like to welcome you to the White House, sir.
Sir, there's been an intrusion.
Let's go, move.
Yeah, that was shit.
Yeah. Of course, you got like Aaron Eckhart there as the president.
Never going to happen. White man as president? Come on.
Have you noticed, though, that actually ever since that Obama got in the White House, the number of black presidents in movies has gone down?
Yeah.
Because they're like, ah, it's happened now. You know.
Yeah, I suspect the number of Asian presidents will go up soon.
Oh, yeah. Some Asian women transgender disabled president will come out in the next movie.
I hope they just come out. That would be great, yeah. Yeah. I don't know if I mentioned earlier on, actually, and I did want to mention it because Effect TV, we cover pretty extensively the Justice League movie.
Which is
coming out the same year as Avengers 2. I'm more excited about the Justice League.
I don't know. I've been fairly disappointed with a lot of the DCA movies. Mm. Like, the first two Batmans were great. I loved them. The third Batman, I...
Shouldn't have happened so soon.
Green Lantern? What was that?
That was hilarious.
What was that? And poor Ryan Reynolds.
His head looks like a fucking foot.
He was so in love with the project. He loves Green Lantern. He loves The Flash. He was dragged in there.
Talked a good talk.
And then...
What happened there?
I don't know. It was like they just didn't really want to film anything, so they did it all on a computer.
Do you know what I liked? All the stuff in space. That was grand.
All the stuff in space? Yeah, it was fine.
It still looks stupid. I'll tell you the worst thing about that movie, and I know it sounds stupid, but often the most important thing about a superhero is the fucking costume.
They had a CGI costume?
Yes.
What is the point?
Yeah.
And it looked like he'd move and the mask would be like half a second too slow.
Could they not have just had an actual mask on his face?
Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah.
And like all they would have had to do was just like, you know, stop the movie, put on the suit, there you go, you're good to go. Mm. And it did actually, it ruined a lot. Is there rumors that he's still going to be Barry Allen, the Flash, in the Justice League?
Absolutely would doubt that wholeheartedly. Yeah,
because that's the role he was after initially.
Yeah.
And if he's replaced as the Green Lantern, he could still hold that if this is kind of like a new DC universe.
Fuck Ryan Reynolds.
You don't like Ryan Reynolds?
Ryan Reynolds? No, I don't ever since that. Do you know, I think there's one role the one superhero role he was born to play was Deadpool. If that movie ever gets made.
Deadpool, yeah.
I wouldn't have to look at his silly fucking face and it's just kind of his fast quips or whatever, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, but anyway, just rushing to that because we've got more to get through. The Justice League has no director attached, only has one actor attached to star. That's the guy who's cast as Superman, Henry Cavill from The Tudors.
Yeah.
I think that Superman movie looks great. A lot of people do. I know you don't feel the same.
Yeah.
But what I'm just trying to say is the one thing they have attached to it is who's actually going to be featured, which superheroes. So you've got Batman, Superman, Wonder Woman, The Flash, and Green Lantern.
Yeah. That's no surprise, really, because in the comic book world, they're known as the Big Five.
Yeah.
And then the Big Three would be Superman, Wonder Woman, and Batman.
What is Wonder Woman doing in the Big Three, honestly? Because
she's as strong as Superman, and she can fly, and she has an invisible jet plane. Has a lasso that makes people tell the truth. And she's the queen of an independent, sovereign nation.
Because there's nothing more action-packed than an invisible jet plane.
Well, they got rid of that now. That was kind of like a budget concern. Yeah. It was like, you know, we need a jet plane. We don't have any money. We need an invisible jet plane.
And in this year's Man of Steel, the one thing they do talk about big time is the fact that there's supposed to be traces of Wonder Woman in it. There's going to be a cameo, some kind of a lead-up into it.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah. All right. So that's that. Look, we better get talking about our next film. It is Oz the Great and Powerful.
Yeah. I think we both know what we both think of this film.
It's a prequel to The Wizard of Oz. I would say probably one of the most unnecessary releases.
Yeah, and Sam Raimi, the director of the original, three Spider-Man films, has been turning out a lot of poo recently, and this seems to be the pooiest.
To be honest, how do you go from The Evil Dead
to I know.
The Wizard of Oz?
Well, like, you know, The Evil Dead was a very B-movie film to start off with. You know, he never really proved himself as a big-time, like, massive budget director until Spider-Man.
Yeah, Spider-Man, yeah.
Yeah.
That was a really ludicrous gamble to give him all that money.
But then what happened with Spider-Man 3?
Studio pressures, I would imagine. If he had probably done what he wanted to do himself, yeah. I think he probably would have been looking at a very different film.
Do we have that clip ready, Martin? Yeah, let's throw it up there.
Let's check it out.
The wizard you've been waiting for.
I think I could be.
An unexpected hero arrives.
Your magic is the only thing strong enough to save us all.
And along the yellow brick road,
the great wizard come to set things right.
Wizard? You mean the prophecy was true?
He'll discover.
I'm Theodora the Good Witch.
Where's your broom?
You don't know much about witches, do you?
Which witch is which? There's Theodora.
You're gonna make the best wizard Oz has ever known. Isn't he wonderful?
She is who he claims to be.
Her sister, Evanora.
How does it feel?
It's like a glove.
Goodness,
you are going to lead us into battle and take back the throne.
And Glinda the Good.
We have an army.
The
of sorts.
That'll come in handy.
We have nothing to fear as long as we believe.
Oz has found the wizard it's been waiting for.
What are you doing? What about me?
You'll be all right. You're a wizard.
I honestly think we have nothing to say about that trailer.
You'd be just as well throwing €15 in the bin as going to see that.
From the maker of every bad movie ever.
Yeah, with the worst voiceover of all time.
I mean, even just the trailer, which is very easy to make a good trailer, like out of hours of whatever footage that you get, and they have no timing or anything or jokes or anything, and I have no idea what's going on.
Like, they say you can't polish a turd, but I think trailers have proved that time and time again that you really can polish a turd.
And polishing a turd is an art form in this modern age. And as you said, trailers should be judged in a category of their own at the Oscars, because some of them are pieces of art compared to the
trailers.
Crap that goes out.
Do you remember the trailer for the original Godzilla movie? Or the reboot, that the fucking awful movie they made years ago?
No, I'm not that old.
It's very exciting. You're not that old? Yeti's married. Sorry, drop that there.
Anyway, do you want to talk about our big film this
yes,
week?
Yes, we are reviewing Killing Them Softly.
Killing Them Softly. You recommended that I watch this.
Yes.
I had seen the trailer when it first came out, but I missed it. Incredible.
Yeah.
Incredible. The director, what's his name again?
I actually don't remember straight off the top of my head. He did the assassination of James.
Yeah, and Chopper. Oh my God, I'm completely after blanking on this. Anyway, the Assassination of Jesse James was one of my favorite movies ever, and this movie too was incredible, and a very, very different movie, even though it starred Brad Pitt as well.
But he didn't take over the movie like he often does.
No, and I don't think anyone actually took over the movie. There was like so many different roles knocking about there, and no one kind of emerged as the star. And I don't think it was that kind of movie. I think it was more of just a story.
If you were to give the film a brief synopsis for the good people, how would you, without spoiling anything?
In a brief synopsis, two young men knock over a card game, and
which is extremely intense. It's one of the tensest scenes.
An amazing scene. Yeah. And then a hitman is hired to take them out and kill them. And that's kind of the basic plot of the film, but it does amazing things with that story, and there seems to be this political backline to it all.
Yeah, it's the whole film is almost like a metaphor for American politics, isn't it? It's like
it's like when they're knocking over the card game at the start, and they are inexperienced and bumbling idiots robbing these like
monsters.
Very very dangerous men of their money, and in the background you have George Bush making a speech.
Yeah,
and like that's a common theme in the film, like. Instead of music in like these bar scenes, you have like Obama or McCain. The whole thing is set at the Obama-McCain election. You have Obama, McCain, and Bush making speeches and all these really tense kind of like criminal discussions. And he's drawing lines between, you know, the candidates and what's happening.
So
in the
there's a political commentary there that would have been very subtle, I find. It would have been one of those films that probably would have been studied, you know, an awful lot. Had it not had that kind of in-your-face kind of, you know, here's Bush, here's McCain, here's Obama.
Now,
I know it helped you get there, but if they had just released it without that, and kind of, you know, over the years, people had to kind of come back to it and go, Jesus Christ, that was such a mirror for what was happening politically.
We actually have the trailer ready here, if you want to.
It's not a trailer, actually.
It's a clip?
It's a clip, so I thought it'd be better than actually playing a trailer.
Okay, let's have a look at it.
Key, I felt like a man.
Mick!
You made me feel good. What?
You gonna be all right? Tomorrow night, the next.
Leave me alone.
Look, I'm supposed to meet a guy, all right? I got a guy to take you around and all.
No, I can't go out.
You come up here to do something, remember? For that.
All right, go get him. Go get the guy and we'll set this thing up. Go get him now, we'll set the thing up. Go get him!
You, I'm gonna tell you what you're gonna do. You're gonna go to bed. I'm gonna call you at 7:30. And if I don't wake you up, I am gonna drop a dime on a couple of cops I know. I'm gonna take you back to where you're supposed to be.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. No ass. No more booze. No nothing. Get yourself a shower and go to bed. I'll get you up and tell you where you gotta be.
I don't take orders from you!
7:30. Get some sleep.
There we go. James Gandolfini. Inimitable, like, but he, again, playing the same character he did really in Sopranos.
Yeah, he does it well, though. I mean, it wasn't the same character. His guy's, like, he doesn't have the gravitas.
Yeah, it wasn't a stretch, though. It was kind of like that same, I like having sex with women and drinking and killing people.
Well, you could say that of a lot of the casting in the movie. Everyone's kind of typecast to, you know, it's very comfortable watching them do what they do.
One of the two boys who knock over the bookies at the start looks incredibly like Casey Affleck, who was one of the stars in Assassination of Jesse James by the coward Robert Ford.
And it's a mouthful.
Yeah, gives away too much of plot in the title as well. Yeah. I've always thought that like Casey Affleck looks like if someone was trying to clone Ben Affleck and it kind of went wrong. And it looks kind of like him, but he's a little weird around the edges.
He's the clone of a clone.
And then this main guy who robs the bookies looks like you cloned the clone.
Yeah, yeah. He's an eighth generation clone of Affleck.
Yeah, and they're kind of getting weirder. It's like that Michael Douglas film, you know, Multiplicity, where he keeps cloning himself and like the last clone is like borderline retarded.
It was Michael Keaton, but yes.
Michael Keaton, who did I say?
Michael Douglas.
Who's Michael Douglas?
God, it would have been a very different film.
Isn't that the guy from the prostitute film?
Yes, Disclosure? Was that she a prostitute? No.
I don't know.
Who is Michael Douglas?
if you know who Michael Douglas is, please email us before next week.
I know who he is.
I think that's all for this week, isn't it, Danny? Do you have more?
I think for this week, that is it, sir.
I am spent of movie information. Completely spent. I'm Shane Ormond.
And I'm a nerd.
Goodbye.
See ya.